there'd be times where you'd have this rising panic that you almost, I can't believe it, I think I might just tip over the edge, I might become insane. And then I'd take myself for a walk. I have had a couple of screaming sessions where I've gone up to get the wood, but that's very rare. Mainly it's just, you just feel solemn and sad and quiet. But there's nothing like the intensity of the grief. Nothing like it.
And a disbelief.
Yeah, and still.
Still disbelief. You know, you just, you can't understand how you just never get to talk to your own son ever again. You just don't. That one will never register properly.
We were both absolutely ecstatic because we'd seen photos of the boat fleet. From the outside looking in, it is a beautiful looking fleet of boats, and for us that was really exciting. Like, you know, it was sort of almost like we landed the dream job.
He had caution, and we did have discussions. We were concerned about the cowboy mentality.
It's very competitive. You know, it's like a personal gain, a personal thing to try and beat the other divers on the boat.
He was new. He wanted to make a good impression. He didn't want to look like a wimp. I'm only talking now. It's not from his mouth.
They said, yeah, it's really hard work. We sort of expected that anyway, but until you put it into the water, you really have no gauge of how hard it is. You are literally getting towed through the water, drag against you and resistance, getting yourself used to the neck bags, new equipment that you'd never really used before, sort of very foreign, very different to the diving that we'd done before. Yeah.
He made it to the surface, alerted the crew that he was in trouble, and it took them nearly 20 minutes to get him back on the boat. And there was no means to get him back on the boat. They were floundering about in the water and hauling him up by his rope. They dragged him along behind the boat because the boat couldn't stop immediately. So the boat's still drifting along, and they're dragging him in by his air hose with his face down in the water. Jarrod had no chance if he was in trouble, none whatsoever, and they had nothing there to help him. No water rescue plan procedure at all.
It made me really upset. I just thought, what did we get ourselves into? Like, you know, of course you'd never ever go up to work in a job if you knew that this was going to be the result. If something happened to somebody on my boat that was next to me, I'd have zero idea of what to do. And if you haven't been prepped in any way, it'd make it very hard to analyse things quickly enough to do something.
We were all in shock, and it never occurred to me that there was so many things that weren't in place. Mm. We were trying to make sense of how does someone die on a boat like this? I mean, what? How do you die like this?
Money's not really the issue. I mean, the whole approach system should be changed now after a life's been lost. To put a $200,000 value on it and a slap on the wrist, I mean, that doesn't really mean anything. So you would like to believe that the justice system is going to take care of people in these situations.
It was a job. I thought it'd be fine. There was nothing to worry about.
It's so unjust. So I guess justice is a real issue now. Justice hasn't been, but it certainly is now.
There are a number of matters that cause us concern. Firstly, it's a self-regulated industry, and the problem with self-regulation is that there's this inherent conflict between a business's interests at protecting its workers' safety, but also its interest in generating profit. In the pearling industry, there's a general diving classification. You're not classified as a commercial diver. If you're classified as a commercial diver, there are a range of safety measures that follow. They obviously want to operate in such a way where they can maximise their return. And if you start to introduce commercial standards to the industry, they're going to complain about cost.
I really would hope they're not putting other divers at risk. Certainly should never happen again, and it certainly should never have happened in the first place.
There's certainly been a process in the pearling industry where safety has been allowed to evolve in a particular direction, and they've been allowed to self-regulate. I mean, because of the remote locations where it goes on, WorkSafe certainly doesn't appear to have been afforded the resources it needs to go out there and check that the pearling industry is complying with, you know, its own self-regulated standards.
You'd never go away to work in a new job thinking that that was going to be the last job that you'd do. And for it to happen in such a, you know, a company of such status, kind of feel like at the moment, who's really in charge of the Paspaley company? Is it stakeholders? Is it shareholders? Who's making the decisions? I don't know.
They should have wanted to know what had happened to Jarrod as fast as they could so that they could put in place things that couldn't happen again.
How do you have a proper inquest when you're talking 6 years possibly after the incident? You know, this, the divers move on, people move on, people's memories change, people's perceptions of what they were doing and what they were thinking and what they saw at the time change.
You don't go through this process of prosecuting, wait for 2 to 3 years for it to go through the courts, and then think about a coronial inquest. You need to do an inquiry when it's fresh in people's minds as to what's happened.
Well, I was wondering how long it might take.
What a coronial inquest can do is it can call everyone who was on the boat on the day to come and give evidence. So you can actually drill down into and find out what happened on the boat on the day in question. We won't really know whether or not Paspaley have brought about any sort of meaningful change to ensure that this doesn't happen again, because they haven't been required to submit to a coronial inquest yet. And only when they submit to a coronial inquest will we really know.
I mean, I feel like I've tried to just come to terms with that I'm not gonna find out. I mean, watching this whole process get delayed and delayed for this long now, I've tried to come to terms with the fact that I won't know.
Someone else gets in the same situation, it's just gonna happen all over again. And some other poor family's going to be put through the same thing we've been put through.
To me, Jazz, you'll be on the breeze, in the trees, and sailing the seas like a truly free spirit. We will miss you enormously and love you forever. Rest easy with our love, mate. We will always be together.
It's certainly not a plan that I wished to be a part of. And so, Jesse, I love you and I honour you and I honour the infinite potential and wisdom that is within you. Thank you.
We're in Tulum out the back in the jungle and we're about to go dive the El Pit cenote.
The most common things that people were talking about was the way you'd slap them on the back and say, how you going, mate? And he talked to them, directly to their eyes, and make them feel as though, well, there was no one else in the room.
To everyone he met too, he always came in for the big bear hug and he was just a very affable, friendly guy.
I looked for his approval before I did anything, no matter the scale of what it was. His opinion was massive to me. I influenced the way I went about everything.
It's fine, hard to make a decision on something without having any sort of sense of approval. It's hard that it's a sense of approval that I'm never going to be able to get.
We'll be in social settings, we'll find ourselves laughing and joking and being amused and chatting easily. But the whole time, you've got this thing in the back of your mind going, how can I be doing this? How can I function like this? What am I laughing about? What's so bloody funny? You know, and that's always happening in the background, always. It could go for a couple of years, and then we hope to have a coronial inquiry, and who knows how long that takes.
I do feel like there's only so much we can do, being where we are, being who we're up against, but, I mean, yeah, whatever it takes, I suppose.
I think now we believe it, but we don't. It's just still too hard to keep living with knowing we're never going to hear him or see him or smell him or touch him and hear his laugh. And we could live a long time yet, and it could be a long lifetime.